We can stand up, please, if you said a pledge. Remain standing afterwards, if you have a prayer.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If we could keep standing up, please. Christine, if you could please prepare for it.
Someone else have a chance today?
I can remember that we didn't.
Well, I do more than anybody since that last term.
I do.
Dear God, we come together today, we give you thanks for the good gift for giving us. We pray for guidance in the matter at hand and ask that you will hear each of us how to conduct our work with a spirit of cooperation. Thank you for all. Thank you for all that you provide to us. Amen.
Amen. We'll go right to item number two, discussion of trust finances. Item one. Before we do that, if we could have a roll call.
Right, Jose Gale, Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Lisa Novello, Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Mary Rubin.
Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Alexander Cardenas, Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Suarez Olympus.
Steve Neepa Trust.
Ralph Duarte, Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Marie Jose, Bayfront Park Management Trust.
Rafael Suarez Rodriguez, Office of City Attorney.
Joe Carolia, Commissioner. Number one, discussion of trust finances.
Thank you, Commissioner. Let's take a look at the statement of activities for the month ending July 31st. That's page number one. You'll note at the bottom there is a negative change in net position of $109,449. Compared to last year, there was a negative change as well in $23,707. And that's basically due to the summer months and the shortage of events that we have during those months. And now if you go to page 11, we'll look at the statement of activities for the 10-month period ending July 31st. So this is a year-to-date comparison from October to the end of July. And you'll see a positive change in a position of $52,686. Compared to last year, we had a positive change of $976,069. And the difference being the expenses that we incurred for Hurricane Irma, as well as in 2017, we had the Rolling Loud event that netted us $542,000. Now, if you go to page 21, that'll show you the profit and loss for, by class, and this is for events. And in the month of July, we had one event, which is the LinkedIn event that we had in Museum Park that provided a net income of $24,000. And page 22 and 23 are the balance sheets. 22 are the assets. We have a total cash ending of $4,053,831. Fixed assets of $6,534,111. Total assets $10,634,542. The next page 23, shows the liability. The important thing to look at there is the unrestricted funds that we have. $3,498,324, and the liabilities and equity balance against the assets. And the last page, which is page 25, is a statement of cash flows, confirming that cash at the end of the period, $4,053,830.58. And after we have a motion and its approval, we'll look at the arrearage report.
Motion to approve.
So moved.
Could you, there's a motion by Alex Pardons and a second by Ralph Duarte.
Sure. You want to do it later?
Nope, not yet.
All right, so we're approving the 1-3. There's a motion, there's a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
It's approved unanimously.
And if we look at the arrearage report, which is page number 24, all the arrears are current, so all those three that are listed there have been paid. And as far as, I apologize for the August financials, which were not ready. We had a couple of issues with some general entry forms last night, so we'll present those next month, the August and September financials.
So then this will be reflected that they're approving the July financials,
right?
July financials, right? Because the August, you said, will be presented next month?
Yes.
Okay, that is correct.
And the cumulative arrears report can just be accepted without objection, right?
Correct.
All right.
There's approval items 3. Minutes from August 21st, 2018 board meeting. Is there a motion?
Motion approved.
Motion approved. Is there a second?
Second.
A second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Approved unanimously. Number 2, consent agenda. Resolution 18-056. Identifying Bayfront Park parking lot description project. Can you
sure. Yeah, absolutely. We've got our small parking lot back here that we needed to have restriped as our business is increasing. So the restriping project was that small lot, the arrows that lead up to there, the directional arrows, as well as the service road where the bus building is. And the, did put that out. We requested quotes, and the lowest bid was provided there.
Is there any further questions in 1? 2. Resolution 18-057. Ratify the Bayfront Park gator repair. Can you explain the board?
Yes, that's a gator in particular, and this was a. This is one of the older gators that needed brake work and body work as well, in the amount of $2,237. In the new fiscal year, we have a study for the longevity of the gators, and we'll probably purchase new gators in the fiscal year.
Any further questions on this resolution? Okay, 3, resolution 18-058. Approved EPMT. FY 2018-19 budget adjustment.
Right. Thank you, Commissioner. The budget that was approved last month, in essence, didn't change total amount-wise. We had a budget, a capital improvement budget of $9.262728, and the, that was operating, and the capital was $11,712728 total. What did change was, in particular, it was adjustment to the special rental income that is line item 201 that in order to balance, we just up that up from 500,000 to 546,396, which is certainly in the realm of probabilities. And the other two things was the transfer in and the special events marketing revenue as noted in the memo to the board.
Any questions on this one?
I do have a question. I actually would like to make a motion to reconsider the vote to transfer the $3 million into the city's general fund. And the reason I'm making that motion is because it was communicated to us at the meeting that this was a request from the city, and I have been unable to ascertain the source of that request, but according to the city manager, that was not a request that was made by the city of Miami. So this is the reason for my motion to reconsider and bring it up to discussion.
This one. What I'd like to do, since this is not in this agenda, is put it for the next agenda and go with the executive director to get the minutes so that we can get the exact wording that when we approve that, we'll accept. Is so we can put it in the agenda for next meeting.
Yes, Commissioner, we do.
But isn't this budget being, this is my, yeah, so when would the transfer be made to the city of the $3 million?
If this board decides by majority that we want that money back, I'm sure this guy would be in front of the city of the, I think the statement you made is not quite what was said here. I think he was trying to get the other permits. So that maybe.
It should be in here, in the package.
I want verbatim. So, and that's not, what you're proposing is not the agenda today. So, you're going to have what you want, but it's going to be at the next meeting we have.
Let me just mention this procedural matter. Under Robert's rules, and I know the chair well knows this, normally the motions we consider are made at the same meeting or the next such meeting, which is this one. So there would be, for lack of a better word, a deferral or something of that rule, because you will discuss that motion at the next meeting, correct? Just to be clear.
Does that motion need a second to move on?
A motion to reconsider needs a second. It would definitely need a second and a vote to reconsider. And then you would get to the main question, but if you're deferring and there's an agreement to defer, and the movement agrees to a deferral, then it would be any such consideration would occur at the next meeting. Did I respond to your question?
Thank you. Let's take this one at a time. She's made a motion. Is there a second? The motion that we're discussing is for deferral on this item for the next meeting. Is there a second to that motion for deferral?
I'll second.
Yeah, there's a second for deferral. All
right. Calling the question here.
Can you please read the motion back?
The motion is to defer consideration of a deferral of a reconsideration of the budget transfer from the trust to the city that was made at the prior meeting. So it's the motion is to defer discussion of the motion to reconsider until your next meeting. I believe that's my
question. Isn't the city, was a little confused with this, is the city allowed to ask us for money when we're supposed to give it?
Yes, sir. Well, I'm simply an assistant city attorney. I'm not the CEO of the city or anything like that. Any, agencies here, do sometimes, request money from other agencies in the city. I mean, it's not unknown, but it's,
for example, the city's money.
Well, right. Exactly. I was going to ask, is this committee under the bylaws of the city?
Yes or no? Does this come under the bylaws of the city? Yes or no? The bylaws of the city are silent on this matter. Your bylaws, yes or no, in chapter 38, there is no discussion. For example, I'll ask
you. Are we independent?
Are you independent? You are partially independent. You're semi-independent. You're not fully independent like the DDA or FDA.
Are you gay or not gay?
Not everything has a black and white.
Put on a breakdown.
Okay, for example, there's a section in the code that says that the MPA gives their budget surplus to the city. There is no such section. It's silent. The code is silent. Am I clear? So it's silent.
Okay, but if the city requests for money, are we supposed to say yes, or can they demand, or they cannot demand?
I think that if the city...
Get money to us next month.
Right, requests money from you, you can consider it. I don't think you must give it if that's your question.
You're not sure?
No, let me be very clear. There is nothing in the code that says you must. So, I think it's a matter for your discretion and decision.
Okay, so the city requests money from this committee is voluntarily for this committee to accept or not accept. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that is what I'm saying.
Let me give you a brief court history. You mentioned the code for the off-street parking. The first time that off-street parking gave money to the city of Miami was when I was mayor. And I made sure that they, from then on, would give us a substantial amount of service. I truly believe, just like I did then, that that's the obligation of all city agencies or trusts when they have service. And I will say it for the record again, the city of Miami needs every dollar that it can get. We have not in the best of financial shape.
Have they asked for official requests?
Yes, sir. I've had conversations with the manager, with the budget director, and at the next meeting, if it's the will of this board to discuss this, we'll get all into it. And if it's a show that some people want, they'll get a show. I promise.
Apparently, the chief wants to bring up the next meeting, so we got it on hold.
Well, it's up to this board. If you want to bring it up in here, or not here, or whatever you want to do. All that I've stated is that if it's going to be heard and it's the will of this board for it to be heard, it should be at the next hearing so you get all the facts, not partial facts. He says, she says.
Right. So we'll know by next meeting if the city manager's making a request.
Well, that's not what we're saying. What we're saying is that the item is up for a deferral vote. We're discussing that, whether you want to defer or not. It's up to this board if you want to hear it or you don't want to hear it. And if you do, then you vote for it for the next meeting for it to be heard. And then we can make sure that you have all the adequate information, not partial information, or as I said, that he said, she said. If the manager is objecting to this money, so I'm somewhat understanding.
I don't think that that's what I said at all. What I said was that there was not, that I was able to identify any formal request made from us. So I think that as an advisory board member, I myself, at least, I recognize my responsibility to Bayfront Park and also to the city of Miami, which is why I voted in the way that I did at the last meeting. Since then, I have information that has had
That's fine, but we'll have all the information up front, including the minutes of what was said or wasn't said, and anybody else from the city of Miami that needs to come in, including another commissioner, if you would like to come in, will be asked to come in. But in the meantime, if there's no further discussion, this board should decide whether you want to hear this next meeting or not. There's a motion to defer this item, as she asked, for the next meeting. Substance board to decide.
I don't remember what you said. Did we pass it unanimously last time?
It was unanimously passed, and for myself, based on a statement that it had been requested by the city.
Well, do you really think that the city's going to say no to this money?
Of course not. But I do expect to take votes at a publicly noticed meeting under correct information. And I think we should all expect that.
Well, I'm not choosing sides here, but I don't think it's a question of correct information. I think the chairman made a speech or whatever the heck it was the last couple, three times about that the city needs money, we have the money, so we voted to give it to them. But I believe personally that they can take it anytime they want. They can disband us anytime they want to.
That's correct.
And we, and quite frankly, going back over the cash flows for the last few years, particularly with the predecessor, I don't understand why we did some of the things, because a lot of things we did was strictly for personal political purposes. So what the city does with the money, that's another story. But they're not going to say no. So I understand what you're saying, but
maybe they can build another park in the city that we need.
And they can do a lot of things. It's our money. It's up to five people up there to decide. Well, excuse me. It's up to administration to decide subject to your approval what they want to do with it. But I would suspect that if we took the vote again today, it would still pass. But you make a valid point, you're entitled to ask those questions.
So again, before the discussion among the members, there was a motion on the floor which was seconded, which was to defer this item to the next meeting for certain information. And again, what I announced, because I just think I should announce it, is that normally the reconsideration is the same with the next meeting, and I think that by deferring it, you would be
that's what we're doing.
Suspending the rule. Right.
Yes,
right. But you're suspending that rule. And, yeah, thank you.
So that also means that currently that the city could use it in its budget process. Am I right or am I wrong?
Well, you know, again, I'm simply, there has been a transfer and that has been made. So unless that is, changed, that was the last action taken.
So the transfer has actually been made?
Well, I see, that's again why I, I want to serve as a board, but I I'm not the CEO of the city, and
The executive director answer if the transfer is made or not.
The transfer has not been made.
Okay.
I would think that this applies to the new fiscal year, 18-19. So, as long as the commissioner, you correct me if I'm wrong, the budget gets the second reading on Thursday, it gets approved.
Well, there was a motion for that money to be transferred. I don't know why it wasn't transferred, but it has been transferred. This board can decide, and truly, as long as it gets to the city by the end of this fiscal year, it's fine. So we have a motion. We got a long meeting. There's a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
What are we voting for?
To repeat, you're voting to defer that reconsideration, which you'll still have to vote on whether you want to reconsider or not until the next meeting, because normally you do a reconsideration at the same or the very next meeting, which is this meeting.
I'll, on this one, do a roll call, please.
Murray, from Saint.
To defer.
Ralph Duarte?
Please speak
to defer.
Yay to defer.
Okay. Not to defer.
Not to defer.
Not to defer.
Defer.
Not to defer.
And Mary Lou Rose is in the room.
Correct.
All right. Let's go to the next item. Item number four, general agenda items. You see in part FTC slip request for proposal review.
Thank you, Commissioner. Your board packet, there is an RFP that the city procurement department has worked on with us. And the memo explains the larger points of the RFP, which seeks responsive proposals from qualified proposers willing to plan, redesign, construct, renovate, redevelop, lease, manage, and operate a mixed-use waterfront facility, including but not limited to a marina, boatyard, dock master's office, ship store, dry storage, wet slip docks, and at least one restaurant. So this RFP is pretty wide open and just seeks proposers and proposals for a term of 5 years with one additional 5-year option to renew. So the fee proposal is open.
This is for the slip?
Yes, this is for the FEC slip.
5 years, extra 5 years, you're not going to get anybody to drop in there. Because the expenses are going to, whatever proposal you get, you're going to get a tremendous amount of this expense that people are going to have to put into that.
Fair enough.
5 and 5, this is not some of the foot of the conscience.
Fair enough.
And the, with the exception of the time, we need to discuss that more in detail, is the rest of this RFP, Assistant City Attorney, something that you have reviewed and you feel comfortable with?
I have done an initial review. I would like to do, and I am generally comfortable with it, but once the board would approve it, I would like to have the opportunity to do a further, more detailed review, and which can be done very expeditiously. There is one comment I wanted to make based on the initial review. Because it's waterfront property, and because we use the term management under the city charter, when we lease or let out a contract to manage waterfront property, it is subject to approval of the voters. So, you know, that needs to be added, and the other voter approval, which is, again, it's a stock clause we have, but based on the initial review, that's one thing I have. The other thing I have, because again, it's an agreement. Again, the trust manages this. This is within the trust's jurisdiction, but it's ultimately city property. And again, because it's an agreement for multi-year, however long it is, it should also go, in my view, if I may suggest, to the commission. The procurement director, the procurement director already has a mechanism for that. If she would be so advised by the administration here, after we make our changes, she puts things on. You may have seen them already. She puts things on and goes, you know, I'm intending to issue this, you know, it could be done formally with a resolution, but she also sends memos and says, I'm intending to issue blah, 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 you know, and please, you know.
Well,
right.
The time, I think, for the city commission to apply is when we get proposal back. And by state law, we have to put this up for at least 90 days.
Yes.
So once we get that back, and if we decide to award this or not award, that has to be clear. But we have to serve that option, not to award it. If we don't find anything that is in the best interest of the trust and the city. But if we go forward, anyone, the city commission must approve.
Oh, yes, the commissioner, the chair, is correct in what they're saying. City commission is, approval is clearly required by law. The city always retains the ability to reject all proposals or not award and so forth. That's standard language, but I was suggesting something even somewhat further than that, saying that you'd actually have the officials approve the issuance of it. Because it's, but that's, you know, I can't tell you that is,
You know, unless the majority of this board would like to do that, I don't see the need for it because we're authorized to, and then at the same time, the commission will have the final say on it. I think that quicker that we move forward on this, the better it is with the trust and the city. I mean, I could be wrong. Maybe we're not going to get anything that's going to be anywhere near what I thought we'd get a proposal here. But at least it's open and wide enough that anybody whatsoever, can present an idea to us and tell us how much they're willing to pay. And I think that the wording on the years, what is reasonable for someone? Is it 50 years? Is it 70? Is it 90? I don't know for certain. It's not 5 and 5. We're not going to get anybody to buy it.
Maybe something that would incorporate not only a certain amount, but also a minimum. Also have a minimum, up to this amount of, but it won't be less.
You say in dollars or years?
Years.
Years. Yes. Well, I think you're correct. We should put a minimum, but up to a certain amount. That works.
Right. And then I don't want to get into the business province of the board or the city, but, you know, it's a matter of procurement law. You always want to want to be conservative, we always want to compare apples to apples and oranges to oranges. So when we put out an RFP of this nature, it's difficult to state the time frame. You know, because when you put an indefinite time frame, you may have a challenge or a protest on the basis that you can't compare one thing to another, and no one knows what they're bidding on. And there's cases on that. So I'm suggesting that you, whatever time it is, if you put in a time.
Well, a certain time for specific uses, some things last longer than others, obviously.
Right.
I think we should all read it. I think we made some good points. You know, the city has standard boilerplate language that it uses in all its RFPs.
Yes.
As far as what has to be adhered to.
Yes.
I think the time is very important because this is going to take a major capital investment, regardless of what goes on there. I agree that we should control the process ourselves, subject to the approval of the commission. But I think we should all read it and discuss it at the next meeting, because that's a very precious piece of property. We want to make sure we do the right thing.
That is correct. I know it's a precious, but there's not going to be any kind of lease or contract that I can conceivably see that we would ever do here that would bring more dollars than this one to the trust and the city. So that's one of a kind. I have no problem for the trust to read it further, but we need to take action at the next meeting so we can move forward.
Are there any restrictions imposed on that slip that so we don't lead people down the wrong path? Is there any governmental or other restrictions?
Unfortunately, Robert is not here, but I believe that he said at a prior meeting when that came up that there was a fine grant that had been used to do something along the wall there, along the bay wall. And what that means under a fine grant is that when you do anything to alter that, it generally means you have to repay the fine grant, which I believe he said was $600,000.
That wasn't much.
That's my recollection.
But what I would venture up, Al, is we have to be sure that we include there is that anything that they are allowed to do there, we're not telling them what they're allowed to or not. It is at their risk of them finding out themselves what they're able to do, what permits that they would need or not, for them to find out beforehand.
Right. Like we normally have that all approvals and permits, only uses that are allowed. You know, typically no gambling, no, you know, et cetera, on city. You know, you just have to be specific enough because you know, because you know, there's numerous cases on this that people know they can. A selection committee who's making a recommendation or, you know, has to know what they're comparing what to what can't be so open that it's unclear. That's all I meant.
If we could agree to bring it back at the next meeting. Beforehand, anybody that has any changes, suggestions, I bring it right to Raphael, let the
right.
Secretary Director know.
Right, yes.
Hopefully we can deal with it at the next meeting.
Well, that's a good idea. As we come up with changes, we should tell him.
Right.
Okay. So we can
tell him and he tells me. I speak to him all the time, or however you want to do it.
Yeah, well, that's a good idea.
And the legality stuff that the basics are here, but it should be dressed up. I would take that time to include some other things that are like I just mentioned.
But I think we all agree that we're going to give more time, like 5 years time enough for doing as a group.
I certainly understood that.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't hear anybody say that that's sufficient. Because otherwise, we should table this one now. Because no one's going to bid on 5 and 5 or something of this nature.
Well, we have good references on existing leases. The waterfront property.
Okay. Is there a motion to defer this to the next meeting?
So moved.
Second.
Been moved by Alex, second by Stephen. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. approved unanimously. Okay. Two, park naming rights.
Thank you, Commissioner. In your packet is a memo and a request for sponsorship, and like the last RFP, this is a model. The points are delineated in your memo, naming rights solicitations for Bayfront Park and Museum Park independently or together. The goal is to secure a naming rights sponsor or sponsors that will maximize the value of sponsorship dollars in the best interest of the BPMT. Proposed term shall be a duration of 5 years with one additional 5-year option to renew. And the selection criteria is listed there as well. In return, the Bayfront Park Management Trust will provide the following: a prominent location for sponsorship naming rights, that signage location to be determined. We've looked at in front of the park along at the entrance of the Flagler Promenade. There is a wall there between Flagler and Northeast 1st Street that's a 2-foot limestone wall that also holds signage. And the marquee as well is another opportunity for the proposer to have signage there. We'll place the sponsorship on Bayfront Park digital marquee sign, inclusion upon the website, and requirement of sponsorship name on BPMT agreements for all promotional collateral event materials, much like when we had the AT&T Amphitheater at Bayfront Park in the early 2000s.
We have in the contract, of course, subject to commission approval.
It's going to be subject to commission approval. That is required by law. And
we said before.
Right. Yeah, and that will. That will be, in fact, what I will do again, presuming the board approves it, I will be sure to add that very expressly there, because it does require commission approval because it's a multi-year agreement. So that change will be made. The other thing that I wanted to mention was we would like just the due diligence of the administration here to confer. We did check, we believe that the Claudine Milbert Pepper only involves
Fountain, but I
just wish someone would you know, be sure to speak to Tim Schmand or somebody that has a lot of history here to be sure that there's not some name somewhere.
No name anywhere else. Otherwise, this would not be called Bayfront Park. It would be called, you know, another name.
All right.
Claude Pepper, Milbert Pepper Fountain. That's why you see the name
right
in the fountain beside it.
Right. So the commission approval will be added here simply because it's it's managed by you, it is a city park, and it's a multi-year agreement.
This, so it have to be a 90-day also.
Yes. There's no reason why you couldn't.
Last but not least, we should have it clear there that we could accept
yes.
or decline
yes.
any proposal.
Yes.
It's obvious that if we're going to get out of real local, we're not necessarily going to be willing to give any direction in local. We're not placing a minimum, it's something we could do, but really I could have gone either way in that. The reason I can push for a minimum is that we might be undercutting ourselves. But I'll hear any suggestions any one of you might have.
Yeah, no, the board favors it. If you go forward with this, we will be sure to add that, I think it's there offhand, but I don't want to, any proposal can be rejected. That's stock language, not accepted, and subject to city commission approval again because it's multi-year in the city park.
The only other request that, from what I'm hearing, the assistant city attorney, that I think I would like to add here, that this is subject to further review by the assistant city attorney assigned to the trust. And if he sees any significant changes that have to be made, it will then be brought to the trust at the next meeting. If they're minor,
yes, that's fine.
It goes forward.
Yeah, yeah.
If the board members are okay with that.
That's very good. That's very good.
All right, is there a motion to approve two park naming rights?
So moved.
Moved by Alex.
Second.
Second by Suarez Menendez. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any nays? Secure unanimous.
Understood. Very good. Thank you.
Okay, commercial dockage license agreement would be.
Thank you, Commissioner. In your board packet is a commercial dockage license agreement for. Carabella. And this user is proposing a 1-year agreement starting beginning January 15th in the year 2019, expiring 1 year later. And it's for use of the South End Dock where we currently have the Seafair vessel. They are proposing, and we're pulling it up now on the screen, to bring in a, I believe it's 230-foot vessel. As a restaurant, lounge, high-end operation. And it's basically a barge that is has a draft of about 6 feet 3 inches, so it would pose no problem there depth-wise. Again, it's 230 feet long, it's 60 feet wide. Karina, you move to an interior shot. And again, the term of the permit, or the license agreement rather, is 1 year. It is $300,000 upfront, January 15th, 2019. There is a 7% kicker on sales above $5 million. And I believe we have a representation here if the board has any questions.
I'm sorry, I was out of the room, but what did we get last year?
What did we get last year for the Seafair vessel?
$144,000
and
change, probably.
What's he talking about?
We're getting slightly over double plus if they make $5 million, which I'm told the estimates is that they can make maybe $15 million, or so they hope. If they hit that $15 million, we get an additional $650. So we make $1 million on the year. No noise, hopefully no problems. We don't have to close the park. And it's 1 year, so that if we need to review it on anything, after the year's up, it comes back and we review it. Yes.
Is it right to my understanding that not only delivering the food and beverage options open up, but it also provides cruises? So it's not always.
They will provide cruises, but I will let the representatives explain that better to you. So you could ask that question better on the cruises that they'll likely have. The bulk of it is going to be, I believe, a dock or restaurant. It's been made clear, and it's in the contract, that they have to abide by city noise levels. Beginning at 11 p.m., any noise, music that might be on the outside space has to come inside. Ask all the questions you don't like. The 7% is on the high end. If you look at what the city has done in the last contract that it's done for restaurants, this is on the high end on percentages. So
Is that 7% or $5 million gross or net?
Gross. The net, you know.
If it was $5 million net, we'd charge a lot more rent.
Yeah.
And every month, I think. Whatever it is, every month, for month to month.
And we get to audit them. They got to pay us right after the first, say they go at $5 million, $1. Begin the next month that they're over that, they only get 30 days. They got to give us the amount that they made, and we'll give them 30 days to then pay us after they do their accounting. So they're in a short lead on each payments. And the $300,000 is paid, whether the ship makes it to port, sinks on the way over, whatever it is that happens, whether they sell the one Coca-Cola or two, we still get the $300,000. That's up front.
I assume risk management gets involved with this because of damage to the dock, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, they're required
all liability.
They're required to have insurance. If they damage the dock through, you know, a vessel accident, under law they would be required to you know, make that whole. By the same token, in the agreement, because of the substantial consideration, if we damage a dock or the dock is lost through a hurricane, we have to restore the dock.
But they're asking some valid questions about the LLC. I think we should let the board know the exact insurance that we're requesting and how much
right.
are they putting everything else.
The insurance that is being requested is commercial marine liability of $1 million each occurrence, general aggregate $2 million, products and completed operations $1 million, personal and advertising injury $1 million, damage to rented premises $50,000, umbrella liability each occurrence $2 million, City of Miami Bayfront Park Management Trust and the city are listed as additional insureds. Contingent liability and contractual, premises operations liability, primary insurance clause endorsement, and workers' compensation as required by state law. Employer's liability of $1 million for bodily injury by accident or disease. Each employee protection and indemnity liability of $1 million. Bumper shock liability, excess P&I liability of $1 million. Pollution liability, $5 million.
And anything above that, if it was our fault, we're responsible.
Anything above that, if it was attributable to our direct fault, yes, in the law, because yeah, but these are not insubstantial insurance coverages. You know, I read off 7 different kinds of coverages.
Based on your long history with the city in litigation, when there have been accidents, do you recommend to this board that those numbers are adequate, or should raise them?
I would answer the question this way. Those numbers have been found to be adequate by our risk management department, and they tend to be conservative.
Whatever questions the board has,
when would this start?
January 15th is the next start.
And I believe the sea vessel is there. What was it called again?
The Seafarer.
Seafarer. They're going to be moved either next door or to the slip, one or the other.
So we'll still have the income from Seafarer as well?
That's correct.
Great. And the representatives here, okay, I just had a question about the operation. Is it going to be a restaurant with operating hours that are normal or more reserved for private events or a combination of both?
For the record, Alex Tatsumas, Blue Sutton Bowen, on behalf of the vessel owner. This will be normal hours of restaurant and bar operations. It's a very high-end operation. The food is prepared by chefs with Michelin star experience. And then there will be a lounge deck as well as the restaurant. But it will be normal hours. As the commissioner indicated, we know that at 11 o'clock at night, all exterior music's got to stop. And before that, we will be complying with the noise ordinance as well. So this is not going to be a type of business that is going to seek out a loud and raucous crowd. It's looking for a more upscale kind of lounge and fine dining experience.
Should we breakfast, lunch, and dinner, or just lunch and dinner?
I'm sorry?
Breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Breakfast, lunch, and dinner, or just...
I think it's just lunch and dinner? Lunch and dinner, for now.
Lunch is starting what time?
What's
that? Lunch at what time?
What time?
Yeah, what he's saying is he's not happy with the food that we've been providing.
It'll be a little bit better than that.
And I'll go by boat. Will we partner with boat?
Can you just give us some details on the cruises? Is it like it's just a cruise around the bay? Is it something that stays?
No, the vessel will be primarily stationary. So it's navigable and will have Coast Guard licenses, but it's primarily going to be stationed at the dock. Perhaps once a week, once every 10 days, it will go out on a dinner cruise, or if it's chartered by a private group. But that won't be the norm. The norm is that it's going to be stationed there so that people can walk from the park or walking downtown and enjoy a nice dinner, lunch, what have you.
We'll see you next month for lunch.
That was January 15th.
Free lunch.
We got our check beforehand.
By January 15th, we have to pay the full base rent up front, $300,000 in cash.
So we took the food prior to the 15th?
Well, we get the check before they get boarded.
Yes.
Motion?
So yeah. Move.
So move.
Second.
By Rob, second. Vice Mayor Fernandez.
And please note that while you vote, I just wanted to see you're going to be voting by four-fifths.
Right.
You're voting four-fifths approval because
per code.
Yeah. Right. Because even though it's 1 year, it's not a routine commercial dock. That's why. That's all. Thank
all
you.
In favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
It approves unanimously by all the board members.
Thank you all very much. Look forward to seeing you there.
Sure. Thank you. Mr. Executive Director, this obviously was not part of our budget for next fiscal year.
That's correct.
So, receivably, we could have maybe up to $1 million, maybe somewhat less if they are successful there, but certainly $300,000 for next budget beginning October 1st. Number four, Live Nation contract renewal.
Thank you, Commissioner. The Live Nation contract, first 10 years, will expire on December 31st of this year, 2018. They have until the end of the month to provide a letter of renewal. And that is in the works. So I'll be conservative and say that we hope to receive that letter.
It's supposed to be received by September 30th?
By September 30th.
So what is the exact date that the contract will expire?
December 31st, 2018.
And they were supposed to give us notice how far before that?
It's six, by the end of the month. By the end of this month, yes. Okay. So they are timely. They know the one coming.
I just want to get it in the record.
They have till the end of the month by contract.
So you will see this in the next board meeting in October, one way or another.
What do they have, an option?
Yeah, yes, that's correct. They have
two 5-year options.
They have 2 5-year options.
Okay, and number five, the FPL solar project update.
The FPL project, we've tweaked the signage language where it provides naming rights to FPL in the event that a third party, in this case, Live Nation, decides not to renew.
Or at any time that their contract expires, so they're not there. In other words, you can safely, after Live Nation gives this contract up in 10 years, even if a new one is done with it, it will then not include naming rights because they will have it.
Right, and if I may, Mr. Chair, just for the avoidance of any doubt and clarity on this issue, and since I feel it's present, I have the language, which is very brief, and I'll read it into the record. The name of the renewable energy equipment they have is before the other signage, which was the moving digital signage that they had to reach an agreement with. They have is before with the trust, but what's changed is it now says, in addition, this agreement does not presently confer any grant or approved naming rights or similar rights to the venue, including future stages, amphitheater, seating, or VIP area within the park that has been confirmed granted to any third person or party. At such time as presently existing contractual naming rights conferred on any third person or party expire or are otherwise no longer in effect, the venue naming rights, as identified and defined herein, are then conferred to FPL for the remaining term of this agreement. All other naming rights to any other facility, feature, area, structure, building, or portion of the park, as well as the park as a whole, are expressly reserved to the trust of the city.
Okay, the only other item I want to make sure we included there, that the trust would have the sole right on deciding where they're putting their name, what size, and anything pertaining to those naming rights, the final say will be in the trust. I don't want to get into a situation that they want to come up with a huge sign, they want to put it in a place other than what we think is appropriate, and then if we have naming rights to this request or proposal that we're putting out, that, you know, they're almost a competition with the people that are paying us, hopefully, a big chunk of money for naming rights in part.
That's why you reserved all other areas, but to be clear here again, because FPL is here and we want to avoid any doubt. So you're saying trust itself or through the executive director shall...
No, the trust itself.
Shall have the sole right to...
The trust through the board.
Right.
Obviously, the executive director will be the one that will
present it.
The size, location,
and content. Is this the renewable energy signage and the venue naming rights both?
Nope.
Just the venue naming rights.
Just the venue naming rights, but for the names and the solar ring that they're putting, we also need the protection of that.
For the renewable energy signage that's older, it already says all signage must be reviewed, approved, or disapproved by trust prior to placement.
Okay.
If you want, I can add that exact language to the venue naming rights. I could add that exact same language.
Well, the venue naming rights, I think you should make it tight, but there. Depending on what they're going to pay us, we could have a little more flexibility.
Right. Well,
they pay more, the sign can be a little
FPL, let's be clear here. FPL is not paying any money for these naming rights.
Yeah, okay. We understand that. They are paying in another way, but they are getting
responsible up to $40,000 a year in certain expenses as defined, which are.
Well, those are business decisions. They're not, you know, I mean, right. You have
a contract
right
with them now, right? I don't understand.
Well, we don't have a signed contract yet.
No. I don't understand. First of all, we don't have the expertise to do that. They have the expertise. And I think it's wonderful that they're building it. Obviously, there's reasons for everything. But I don't understand why we should be responsible. We can't be responsible for everything. Can't be responsible for a few $100,000 a year from Museum Park. I still don't think a lot of board members realize how much money the Bayfront Park Trust contributes directly and indirectly to the city of Miami, like New Year's Eve, for example. That's on our dime.
Yeah.
And
so
I don't want to put FPL in the spotlight, but they're here, maybe you want to. I'm not able to answer that question,
okay?
I have no problem with anything except that one thing. It just sticks. You got a major American corporation. I tried to look up my phone what the profit was last year. Anybody have any idea what the bottom line was last year? Billion? I don't know. For dividends? The point is, it's a lot of money. So why, if they're spending, what, $25 million to build this? Am I right or wrong?
Well, that's what they've said, but
okay.
We haven't seen any.
Why in a row would they want us, who have absolutely no expertise in this at all, to spend up to $40,000 a year for maintenance? They're talking about cutting the grass, making sure it's clean, stuff like that.
But
I don't have an issue.
See, but I think that the FPL representatives are here. They're the appropriate party to answer that question, not our assistant city attorney.
Correct.
Well, it's passing it off the hand of my team.
You guys can get up here, just identify yourself.
David Bates from Florida Power Life, project manager for this. Part of it, and I want to reiterate, is part of the project that we're trying to build for the city has nothing to do with solar, which is what we generally maintain. This primarily, one of the big benefits, is a retractable canopy, which covers that. We are also not in the business of retractable canopies, and that is not something we wanted to be responsible for. We know that it's a benefit to this particular site. We know that it's something the city has looked for and actually asked for in previous minutes that you've had. So that is, we're investing millions of dollars in that, and all we're asking you in return is to maintain at least, you know, that's a portion of it.
And who's going to tell us what to do? I mean, theoretically, I don't have a problem with the $40,000 a year, although we are laying out a lot of money for a lot of people in the city, a lot of city functions. But I don't see where we have the expertise unless you tell us this, and you guys spend up to $40,000 a year, and this has to be fixed, and that has to be fixed.
And that's why we don't have the expertise in that either, and that's why we went to the manufacturers of this and asked them what you anticipate it to be, and that's what they estimated, and that's what we provided.
But we don't know what to fix.
Again,
we're to maintain.
Again, the manufacturers recommend a certain amount of maintenance associated with it, that we'll rely on their guidance, and anything above that, you know, we're saying we would.
And that $40,000 includes some of our labor, people that we have on the maintenance payroll now, and we were assigned a certain, whatever the actual hours are that they work, times the hourly rate. But does it have to be outside what the park normally does?
I don't know exactly what the agreement says, but I believe you just simply submitted invoice to us. I believe that was it.
That's it. And right, it provides in the maintenance. The maintenance section provides that they invoice us. They maintain it and they invoice us because FPL has the qualified personnel. I wasn't under set. So and then they invoice us. It says that they're not supposed to. They're supposed to invoice us like their direct costs, not like other charges. And then we are required to pay it to the amount that we've agreed to pay. That's what it says.
Yeah, I mean, so based upon the manufacturer's recommendations, we are paying it. Yes, I believe you're right there. And then we submit that. Or
oh, we reimburse.
Yeah, you just reimburse.
Oh, I don't have a problem.
Okay.
I just don't want us to do anything stupid and be penalized for it. Based upon what you're saying, I don't have a problem.
I do recall a prior draft of the contract that said that the trust, it read the word trust, up to those $40,000 would be responsible. In a more recent draft, the latest one that I saw, it actually said the city. So can you clarify, are we considered the city in that draft?
I believe
it is the trust, not the city.
Okay, but it does say city.
I think that that's probably just a mistake or a typo that we will go over on the maintenance because, at the beginning of the agreement, because again, this is a long-term agreement, 25 years, yada, yada. it is with the trust, but we also put the trust as like a subset of the city because it's a 25-year agreement, it's a city park. But for these day-to-day things, it is a trust. So if it said the city, I apologize. That was a typo or an error, and it should be the trust.
So is the agreement going to say that we reimburse them? Does it say that? I don't have a problem.
Yes, that's what it says. It says that's what it says on me.
Any further discussion? Any changes that anyone would like to make or additions?
So the venue naming rights will be changed in the way that I read out and in the way with the additional sentence by the chair, and it would be that approval that. The trust shall have sole right to decide the size, location, and content of all signage relative to the venue name rights, which are conferred to FPL after the end of current contracts. That's it. It should be very clear.
We have to go to this contract, and it is going to be forward. So is there a motion?
Make a motion.
Second by Mr. Niebler, second by Mr. Suarez Menendez. Any more further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 No nays. It passes unanimously.
As amended.
As amended. Okay. Director's report, made by any same parts.
Thank you, Commissioner. I want to start here at Bayfront Park at the September 13th. City Commission meeting, Crown Castle was approved. So, as a matter of fact, I just received the signed contracts from Crown Castle. And as to remind you, that is the cellular nodes that are being placed in Bayfront at Pacific Park. Two is the canopies. We've sent you an update on the canopy replacements, which are complete. So, you have photos of that. I'd like to go back to Museum Park on the Baywalk project and the Phase 4 Promenade project in front of both museums. And those projects are coming to conclusion, and they'll be substantially completed by the end of October, and hopefully a ribbon cutting ceremony will take place, and we'll coordinate that. I want to talk about the fountain real quick. Last Thursday, I had a visit from the Army Corps of Engineers, as they do hold a lease here on Park property, and I showed them the fountain. And also, I've been working with CIP, and they produce a work order for an engineering assessment report on the fountain. And those engineers came out, and they are going to assess all the systems, including electrical, plumbing, structural, mechanical, life safety, and they're going to recommend to us whether to repair or replace each system and upgrades. So that study is $46,052, which is not a surprise. I expected under $50,000, and the CIP did come through for us on that. So. As soon as we get the report, I'll share that with the board and see how we'd like to proceed forward.
I received an unsolicited email from some firm, I don't remember their name, from that claimed they had all kinds of experience in how this is going to work. I'm going to forward that to the executive director, so you can look. See if they can do this right or less, and at the same time make sure they are qualified to do it. Because once we get a final report, that's when the big bills are coming. So,
right. And let me just say that from that final report, and then we bring it to the board will hopefully decide which route to take. So we can put that out for bid and have some responses to that.
What is the timetable on that study across the
Well, I don't have that answer, but
think it's rather quick. So I'll ask the question and send you an email about that.
I want to tell you about that statement. If it's a city of land, it's definitely quick.
That's what I asked.
Upcoming events?
I want to talk about New Year's Eve real quick. We did have a meeting about this New Year's Eve with AIM Productions. AIM Productions is the Pitbull production company, and they would like to come back to the park for this year and pretty much fashion the contract in the same way that we have provided financial support to them.
What was the amount of the financial support that we provided to them?
No more than $300,000.
I understood that the $300,000, whatever the amount, about $200,000 was approved. It was a one-time deal prior to that. I believe it was like $200,000.
Yes, it's $200,000 is what is in the budget, line item 22-24 Event Opportunity Fund. And then the trust kicks in $100,000 for city services and production costs. The cost of the event last year was $233,937.
$233,000.
And that
for
everything, yes. That includes grants that we received from Miami-Dade County in the amount of $55,707 and a surcharge for the VIP area of $3,950.
Okay, question. Last year, for the first time, he did not have any TV for his event.
That's correct.
And the reason we have been providing all this money was because we were getting something to make it value with TV.
Yes, sir.
Last, the talks that we had were to the effect that they were supposed to be negotiating TV rights with somebody.
Yes, sir.
Do they have TV rights?
Let's go back to last year and I'll answer that question. Last year, Univision came to the plate late.
Then you go live.
No, they had three segments.
Three segments and whatever they were doing, but then you go live.
That's correct.
What do they have for this year?
For this year, they have, it's going to be a 6-hour Univision worldwide event. They're going to have 6 to 7 segments from Miami, and they expect a viewership of about 50 million.
Okay, so what you're saying is the Univision worldwide event.
Yes.
They'll draw us in a few segments, maybe.
That's correct.
But when the midnight comes, it ain't going to be Miami who's going to be showing anywhere in Univision.
We don't know that, but that's a distant possibility, well, absolutely.
But we better know beforehand, because it's a lot of money we're putting out.
Yeah, but that money is net of the grants that we got too, right? Or am I calculating wrong?
Well, you said the last year, actual money that went out was $233,000.
That's correct.
So that's net of what we received. It was more before we got the grants?
Yes, it was $293,000.
But this year?
And we ended up giving out $233,000.
Right.
We don't know what's going to be this
correct.
Year, but I doubt it was going to be anything better for us than that of last year. And I just want to be sure that before we have a final agreement, that we know what we're getting.
Right.
I mean, we all love Pitbull, but this is a business for him. And we're also trying to not only bring the best show to our locals, but trying to promote Miami, either nationally or internationally. Yes, Rob.
Commissioner, I love the event. I come every year for the last 20 years. When they originally came to us 4 years ago and they requested $300,000, we accepted the deal and the idea was that we would be eventually making money out of the event when they originally came. I think if we gave them 200,000 cash, I think we need to scale down. Take in the next 10 years, $20,000 per year or something. And they're not going to back out of this.
One, we have permanent here. And I'd like to see that if they don't want to use that for additional shows, that we could use that during that time. And with whatever money we scale them down, we could bring some other shows to put them.
They will probably need both stages, because when they are setting up one, if they're on TV, they will need both stages, most likely.
Did they use the other one, the last one?
Last year they did not.
But they were not live. If you're going to go live, you're going to have somebody here, and they need to be able to switch to the other.
This is why we're going to need to speak to them and get all the answers up front, not, you know, a month or 2 weeks before. So that we'll come to you the next meeting. Everybody knows really, you know, what we're getting and where we're at.
When we were doing the events on our own, how much were we?
Oh, it was 100 plus.
Yeah,
150,000 was nothing.
Yeah, and that's, I would like to see it saved, but I totally agree with you that we have to make some financial payment. We have meetings with Univision and board that are talking to, so we need to find a way to benefit. Well,
I'm glad that you all are thinking that way, because my way of looking at it, for $250,000, we could throw a heck of a shindig. And we could bring, you know, quite a few class acts to come and perform it.
But from experience in the previous years, we were spending $150,000 and there was no big talent or anything because of security and everything else that is included. So, I mean, for the type of advertising we get, I mean, that's the type of advertising no money can buy. If they are live from here.
Well, that I agree. That's why I'm pushing on those TV rights, see what we get. You mentioned 150 that we spent in the past. We didn't have any big talent. Well, we got another 100,000, which we could bring in some real big talent with additional 100,000.
Production cost, because basically we would do a DJ, security, fire, cleanup, fireworks, and there you lost $150,000. So if you bring an artist, you also got to do the production, stage, lighting, sound. I think we have a good deal. I think we just need to scale back to the point where it doesn't cost us anything eventually.
I hear you. I think it's important to know, so what he's saying is, how many segments are we going to be involved with?
Yeah.
Each segment, how many minutes or segments are going to be?
And that
is going to be national or international. Right. There's, in my opinion, there's going to be no widespread view of Miami at the national international level. It could be PDD or DDY or whatever, big deal. We had no exposure.
Well,
I didn't think it's to get exposure.
I would reconsider everything. They have the segments, it's from America. I go back to what Rob was saying. But anyway, we'll bring this back to the next meeting. We'll try to get you all the information. And then, I've heard all of you get enough of guidelines to what you want to see. And we'll talk to the class and bring it back to you.
I need to step out. I have something. It's been half an hour or so.
Okay, we're almost done. Anything else?
I have just one more item regarding vacation policy, Commissioner. And I just want to bring that to the trust's attention, that this past year, has been an extraordinary year, out of the ordinary, with Hurricane Irma and with the loss of staff here, particularly finance director and maintenance director. A couple of free employees that have not been able to take vacation fully, and that's myself included. And I'd like to be in a dialogue with the board to have our vacation time mirror the city's vacation policy a little bit more closely. Right now we have a policy of, you don't use it, we lose it. speaking for myself, I have 128 hours which I have not been able to take. So if I don't take it by the end of the month, I'm out.
128 hours, this was for a year. Well, what I would do is, here's the plan, so the executive director for something officially forward to the board. Let's, Counselor, you advise me if it's appropriate the way that I'm going to send this resolution, that we give him an extra 6 months to use up the time so he will lose it. For him and the other two members of the trust, and during that time, before the 6 months expired, they can bring us a resolution to the effect of what he's talking about so that we could either mirror the city or come to our old way of doing it. But in the meantime, these green employees that have worked well, the reason you said extra
attention.
They weren't able to take their vacation. Okay. They should lose it. So we give them a 6 month extension to use their vacation time, but in the meantime, they'll bring a resolution back to us that this board can approve before the end of this fiscal year, before the end of this regular year, December. And if for any reason they aren't able to use that time, if the board decides to go the route of the city or something similar to that, they can keep it.
Right. Yep. You need a motion, and I think what the chair said sounds fine legally. I just want to confirm one thing. That vacation policy, Director Gale, is not in a, not in the code that I know of. It's simply a policy. So that's correct. All right, that's fine.
But you don't want to follow city policy, there we can do.
I'll make that motion.
A second.
Okay. Motion is a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Pass it. What are you going to get?
This week.
All right. Imagine the hurricane. I'm saying, where do we stand with FEMA? With our money.
Two brief questions before we adjourn about upcoming events. The Fan Fest, does that involve any park closure?
No. Fan Fest. Fan Fest is in the center of the park, is that correct?
Yeah.
And
Fan Fest is loaded in on October 14th. The event's on Saturday and Sunday. You will have access to the park during the load-in.
Okay.
We will close Friday night, and it's going to be bike racks, not going to be fencing. The event on Saturday is from 12 to 10, Sunday's 12 to 7. On Saturday afternoon, they're going to have F1 Live. They're going to race the cars on between 1st Street and 5th Street from 3 p.m. to 4:30.
We haven't approved them, but the board have.
The event, yes, the event's been approved.
The event
was approved last week. Exactly. Did we say how much we were going to charge them for that?
No, we did not.
So it wasn't fully approved.
How many days is that event?
It's a Saturday.
It's only one afternoon.
What we did, we approved it in principle. So,
question, what's how much of that with Ultra? Are they on or off?
Excuse me?
I haven't heard what's up with that.
Ultra's going before the city commission Thursday.
It's up to them, not to us.
They're the fathers of the city. We'll find out what happens there. Okay. And we'll bring you the news.
And what's been
I would like to state that the $3 million that the board approved to go to the city has nothing to do whether Ultra is approved or not. As you all know, the budget we approved, Ultra was not included in this next fiscal year's budget. So we're fine whether we have Ultra or we don't have Ultra. Furthermore, beyond the budget we approved, as we approved today, you're going to be looking at more things that will be coming to you. We're bringing in a lot more money to the trust.
Where are we with the Grand Prix? Is that on off or what's up with that?
Well, I don't know. They not bring it next year, so it's not going to go next year. So I don't know what they're planning on doing with it. I'm just, you know, can you, maybe the strong mayor will tell us.
What's that going to be with the regular Grand Prix or the electric Grand Prix?
Huh?
Which Grand Prix is going to be that? The regular or the electric
Grand Prix?
So it's a different type of one.
What you mean, the...
Yeah, the cars.
Singapore one or the Houston one?
Right.
Is that what you're saying?
One is the real one, one is the Mickey Mouse one.
Well, they said that this is the real McCoy. I don't know.
This is the one from Monaco, the one in Dubai, the real cars.
Monaco, Dubai, right. Singapore.
And so
they didn't want to go to Houston to see anything because they said they couldn't really get a good feel for the real one. So,
so this year it's not coming, 19 years not coming.
Not that I know. But
so it's up to again, the mission to the cipher.
Yeah, it's the commission has to decide from over there.
For 220, right?
I do understand there was, I believe, in my memory, doesn't fail me, that the city put $100,000 or something for next fiscal year's budget for that, but I don't know.
Yeah, talking about exposure, that's a great exposure.
Yeah.
This is a worldwide.
Well, there's a lot of things that give exposure to that.
That's huge exposure, right? Worldwide.
You know, one of the things we keep forgetting about with our future cash flow is that have we received any money from FEMA yet?
No, we have not.
And how much is on our books now that they, theoretically that we've actually laid out?
About 800,000. We're about to lay out another 239,000 to pay for the canopies. But as you know, you all well know, it's a process, and you know, we try everything just to do the process alone.
What are we getting for the Formula One Fan Fest? I haven't seen that budget.
$100,000.
Is that what they agreed to?
That's what we're offering up. That's what.
Yeah, but forget that was not my question. Did they agree to that?
We're working on it. No, we're working on it.
So I think they were looking at something somewhat less than that.
Just a housekeeping item, Commissioner. If we didn't approve the consent agenda, I explained resolution 56 and 57, and then we voted on 58.
Motion to approve the remaining items.
So, second.
Right. Motion and second, but I believe you
didn't. No, you didn't. Yeah. I thought you had, but you said you didn't approve both of the
I thought we did, but if we did. Motion is a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. It passes again, I think.
Thank you.
All right. Speedy and Stetson, thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much.